I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Dick Beardsley.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is an honor and a pleasure to be here. Thank you very much, Jim, for that nice introduction. You know, I've seen that video literally thousands of times over the years, and yet it still makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up every single time. And every time I see it, I keep thinking, maybe this time I'm going to beat him. It hasn't happened yet, but you got to think positive, right? You know, I could talk to you today and title my talk, How to Run 13 Consecutive Marathons, Each One Faster Than the One Before. But I think a better title for my talk would be, is How Can You, FHH, Grow for 5 Consecutive Years in a Row? I know you've had a great year this past year, and that's wonderful. But now the key is to keep it going year after year after year. Today I'm going to talk to you about the 4 P's. The 4 P's that helped me be successful as a runner, I really firmly believe that can help you be successful, FHH, as a business and continued that upward growth that you're having to this day. Those 4 P's are this, that really helped me become successful as a runner. Positivity, passion, paranoia, and perseverance. I'm going to start off with positivity. You know, when I was a kid growing up, my whole world revolved around the outdoors. Hunting, fishing, farming. The thought of doing anything athletically never really crossed my mind. I was so into the outdoors and things like that. But when I was 17 years old, I was just starting my junior year of high school. And in that early fall of 1973, that first day of school, girls I started suddenly taking an interest in. But I was such a shy, bashful kid, I couldn't even think about saying hi to a girl, let alone actually speaking to one. I tried to keep a positive outlook at it, but boy, it wasn't going very well. But I noticed that a lot of my friends and the guys in my high school that were out for sports, that participated in various sports, always had a lot of girls around them. So I thought, that's it. All I've got to do is go out for a sport, and I'll have girls come to me. So now in the U.S., in high school, in the fall, football, American football, is the big sport that everybody wants to do. And the guys are big and bulky. But I thought, my golly, I'm going out for the football team. Well, look at me. I'm built like a toothpick. My coach tried to talk me out of it. He thought I was going to get hurt too much. But I was bound to determine I was going to be a football player. That first day of practice, I'll never forget. The coach took that football as he was explaining what we're going to do for practice, and he threw it towards the end of the football field, and he hollers at me. He says, Beardsley, get the fumble. Well, I'd never played football before, but I took off sprinting as fast as these skinny little legs would take me, and I jumped on that football. And when I did, moments later, about 19 other guys jumped on top of me. When I fought my way out of that massive humanity, when I got out of that pile of guys, my football helmet was on crooked, my shoulder pads were sticking out, my football pants were down to my ankles, and at that point I'm thinking, there is not a girl alive that is worth going through this. So I quit. I actually walked off the field. My entire football career from start to finish lasted 43 and a half minutes. That was it. Now, I'm trying to keep real positive about it, and about the only positive thing I could come out of it, but what it was a good one, is that, well, at least I'm able to walk away and I don't have any broken bones. Well, a couple of days later, a good friend of mine says, Beards, I know you failed at the football team. You ever thought about going out for the high school cross-country team? I asked him what it was. He says, well, we run through the fields and up and down through the hills. I thought, gosh, that might be kind of a fun deal. And once I found out they didn't tackle you, I was really excited about it. So I showed up for my very first day of cross-country practice. And my coach says, all right, boys, line up out there on the street in front of the school. We're going to do the around-the-block run. Now, I'd never run before, but I knew this. I knew I was determined enough, I was stubborn enough, and I had a positive enough attitude that I could hang with my teammates and go around that block. The coach blows his whistle and off we go. We get down to the end of the first street corner and we turn left. I'm right with all my teammates. We get up to the next street corner. We turn left there. I'm still right with all my teammates. And now I'm thinking, okay, we get up to the next street corner. We take the next left turn. Back to the high school. Practice is over. Boy, I'm going to like this cross country. So we're coming up onto the next street corner and I start leaning to the left. But they keep going straight. I'm thinking, I guess they're feeling pretty good today. They're going to run two blocks. Well, we get up to that next street corner, and I don't just lean left. I actually turn left, but they kept going straight. At that point, it felt like somebody had their hand down my throat trying to rip my heart right out. It felt like my lungs were about ready to explode. Pretty soon, we were out of streets in town and out into the countryside, and not long after that, they were so far in front of me, I could no longer see them. Thankfully, one of my teammates came back to where I was struggling to put one foot in front of the other. And he says to me, Beards, follow that road you're on all the way to the end. When you get to the end, turn left. When you get to the next street, turn left there. And it'll take you back to the high school. And then off he went. Well, I came to find out what they called their around-the-block run was actually 5 kilometers long. Now, that doesn't seem very far to me today, but back then it seemed like forever. I had to walk the last couple of kilometers. I could not run. By the time I got back to my high school parking lot, all my teammates and my coach had showered and gone home. But when I crossed that imaginary finish line, I was so excited. I remember thinking to myself, gosh, Dick, I don't know how far you just ran and walked, but you made it. And I'll just bet you, Dick, if you do what your coach tells you to do, if you believe in yourself, if you have that positive attitude, I'll just bet you, Dick, you can get good enough to make that varsity squad. That was my whole goal, because I knew if I made the varsity squad, I figured I could get a date with a girl. That was my whole inspiration at that point. I did everything my coach told me to do. I showed up on time for practice. I never complained about a workout. I even ran on the weekends when I didn't have to. But I wasn't very good. I didn't make the varsity team. But when our season ended that fall, I didn't run another step. But I had made myself a promise. And I'd set myself a high goal. That when school got out for summer vacation, my goal was to run every single day that summer, and I did. Most days, not real far or real fast, but I ran every single day because I so wanted to make that cross-country team, that varsity squad, and it was exactly 1 year to the day. My senior year of high school, we showed up for that very first day of practice, and we did that same exact run, but this time, all of my teammates, instead of finishing in front of me, they all finished behind me. Now, that's not saying a whole lot because we didn't have a real good team, but it showed me that if you are willing to do the work and put in the time and the effort and stay determined, stay positive, even with the little setbacks you may have, don't let anybody, especially yourself, ever stand in your way of those hopes and those dreams. Now, saying all that, as people see that video that we just showed, they think, man, I must have come out of my mother's womb with this pair of running shoes on, and I got a full-ride scholarship to a major university, onto the Olympics, and so on and so forth. Well, first off, there was no scholarship after high school. I did, however, go to the University of Minnesota, just not the University of Minnesota most people think about. I went to the University of Minnesota / Waseca, a very small two-year agricultural college in Waseca, Minnesota, which is now a federal prison. So it kind of tells you about where I got my college degree from. But that's a whole nother story. But I had a coach there that I'm still very close to this day. And you know, when somebody says something to you or you say something to them, whether it be positive or negative, you never know how it's going to affect you or that person at that moment, later in the day, tomorrow, next week, next month, or years down the road. And one day, Coach Folkrod put his arm around my shoulder and he says, you know what, Dick, I really believe you can become as good of a runner as you want to be. And I never, ever forgot that. And when I got into college, it seemed like the further I ran, the better I was. So in college, I could run up to 10 kilometers. I did pretty well at that distance. And then I heard about this thing called the marathon, 42 kilometers long. So when I was 21 years old, I ran my very first marathon. I didn't know how to train for one. I finished, I ran 2 hours and 47 minutes, and I remember thinking, I'm never doing one of these things again. It took so much out of me. But a few months later, I ran another one and ran about 10 minutes faster. But again, I said, I'm never going to run another one of these because I hurt so bad. But then I figured and found out that to be successful at anything you do in life, whether it be in sports, in business, whatever, is that you've got to prepare properly for it. Do the things that it takes to be successful. After college at the University of Minnesota Waseca, I actually did get a partial scholarship and ran at South Dakota State University on the cross-country team there, where my first season there in 1978, we were second at the National Collegiate Championships in cross-country. But at the same time, I also met a young gal there. We fell in love. We decided we're going to get married. I thought, well, gosh, I've got a two-year degree. I'm going to move back to my Minnesota dairy farm, and I quit running. Yes, I love to run, but I thought I can't make a living being a runner. So I moved back to my Minnesota dairy farm. And it was a positive move for me. We talked about positivity. I want to talk a little bit about passion. You see, yes, I had a passion for running, but I also had a passion for being on the farm. So I moved back to my Minnesota dairy farm and didn't run another step for the next 3 months. And then one day I'm getting ready to go out to my barn to do chores. And before I did, though, I walked out to my mailbox to get my mail. I grabbed the mail, I brought it back into the house, and I threw it on the table. And I happened to have a little time, and I noticed one of my running magazines had come, so I started paging through it, and I saw an article in there on what it took to qualify for the 1980 Olympic marathon trials. You had to run 2 hours, 21 minutes, and 56 seconds. Now, my best in the marathon at that point was almost 12 minutes slower than that. But all of a sudden, I thought back to what my coach said about how he really felt I could be as good of a runner as I wanted to be. And I thought, as I'm standing in my dirty old coveralls, you know, Dick, you can farm when you're in your 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, but you can never chase that dream of seeing how good of a runner you can become. So at that point, I made that decision. The passion for running had returned. And the next morning after I got done milking my barn full of cows, I drove into the big city of Minneapolis, looking for a cheap apartment to live in. I finally found a small apartment on the outskirts of Minneapolis. It was going to cost me $400 a month. I didn't know how I was going to pay for it every month, but I figured I'd figure out a way. Because when you have a passion, you don't let anything step in your way. And I started training, not once, not twice a day, but many days, three times a day. The one and only pair of running shoes I owned, they were so worn out, I had to duct tape them together. But I had no extra money to buy any. And I knew if I went to my dad and asked to borrow $50 or so to buy a new pair of shoes, I knew what his answer was going to be before I even asked it. It was going to be a big fat no. You see, my dad thought I was crazy. What do you mean you're going to see how good of a runner you can become, he said. You see, my dad was waiting for me to fail so he could look me in the eye and tell me, I told you so. Now, saying that, my dad would later go on to become one of the biggest supporters I ever had. And then I caught wind, heard about a big convention coming to Minneapolis, and all the running shoe companies from around the world were going to be there. And I thought to myself, well, gosh, I'm going to get myself a sponsorship. Now, that's pretty big doings for a guy that's an average runner at best. But like I've always told myself, what does it hurt to ask? What's the worst thing anybody can say to you is, no thanks, we're not interested. So I typed up 12 one-page resumes. I had to double and triple space it just to fill a whole page. I then drove to this big convention hall a week or so later. And I walked into the convention hall and I went up to every single running shoe company that was there, introduced myself, shook their hand, handed them a resume, said thank you very much. And when I left to go to the next running booth, I could hear this crumpling of paper and I looked behind and my little resume was going right into the garbage can. I was now down to two shoe companies I hadn't talked with and one resume. And I kind of went like this, turned myself around, and I looked at the New Balance booth, and the gentleman's name I'll never forget was Hal DeWaltoff. Once again, I went up, introduced myself, handed him a resume, but you know what, folks, this time, he was the first one. He actually looked at it. He says, Dick, I'll be honest with you. The times you've run at various distances aren't very fast, but you are improving. But he says, what I really like about your resume and about you, I can tell by your voice you have a passion for this sport of running and the goals that you've set down for yourself here. I really like that. And his next question to me was, so Dick, what size shoe do you wear? And my immediate response was, what size you got? I was ready to cut my toes off if I had to make them fit. I said, about a size 9. And he reached underneath his desk and he pulled out a pair of these New Balance size 9 running shoes. He says, Dick, why don't you try these on? So I put them on. He says, run down the hallway. See how you like them. So I jogged down the hallway a little bit. I came back. I took those shoes off, put them in the box, set them on the counter. And I said, Mr. DeWaltoff, and I meant this from the bottom of my heart, these are the nicest running shoes I've ever had on in my life. He says, Dick, how would you like them? I said, oh my goodness, I would love them. But I said, I can't afford a new pair of shoes like that. No, Dick, I don't mean you have to buy them. Here, they're yours. Take them. You can have these. And when I get back to Boston, where our world headquarters are, I'll put a little package of things together for you, and I'll see if I can get you hooked up with our coach, Bill Squires. And with that, he shook my hand, wished me all the best, and I put that box of shoes underneath my arms, and when I walked out of that convention hall, I didn't feel my feet touching the ground. Boy, you talk about fueling my passion now. About 10 days later, I'd just gotten back from an afternoon workout when my apartment manager called me and says, Dick, I got a big box down here. It says New Balance all over it. I couldn't get down to her office quick enough. I literally sprinted down to her office. There was this giant box. I had to turn it sideways to get it into my one-room apartment. I took it into the small little living area I had, and I opened up that box. Inside were 10 pair of New Balance running shoes. There were new shorts, socks, singlets, warm-up suits. I sat there and I cried like a little baby. Not because I got a box of free shoes, but because somebody besides me, Dick Beardsley, believed in what I was trying to do. Just like Jim Lafferty believes in all of you. And the next morning when I got up and I put on a new pair of shoes and a new pair of shorts and a singlet and I went out for a run, I had a quickness in my step that I never ever had before. Just that alone. So fueled the passion, my running started to continue to get even better and better. And then I got hooked up with a guy named Coach Bill Squires, one of the greatest long-distance running coaches in the world. Coach Squires just celebrated his 86th birthday. When he was my coach, he was just younger than I am right now, actually. But boy, he had a passion for the sport, and I had a passion for it because of him. He lived in Boston. I lived way out in Minnesota. I would always tell Coach, Coach, don't call me after 9 o'clock at night because you had me so riled up and pumped up. All I wanted to do was go out and do a 30-kilometer run when I got off the phone with him. Under his tutelage, I ran the New York City Marathon in 1980 and finished 9th overall. Set a new personal best. Then I ran one in Houston and set another personal best. Then I went to Japan a few weeks later and set, fortunately, another personal best. I mean, the passion for me for running was unbelievable. And then I got a call to come and run the very first London Marathon. I thought, wow, London. Never been to London. Heck yeah, I'm going to run the London Marathon. And I actually won my very first race, marathon I should say, the 1981 London Marathon. But I didn't win it alone. That gentleman there in the black singlet, that's Inge Simonsen from Norway. Inge and I tied. It was a dead heat. We both sprinted as hard as we could to the finish line, and we both came across the tape, the finish line banner at the same time, and they both awarded us first place. And we've gone on over the last 40 years to become very good friends. My grandma came from Norway and settled in the United States. Boy, you talk about fueling my passion. And then I wanted to run my home state race, the big one, the Grandma's Marathon. You think, Grandma's Marathon? You don't look like a grandma. It's not for grandmas. The sponsor of the race is a restaurant called Grandma's Restaurant. And I ran that race that year. My hometown race, not mainly my hometown, but my home state race. I trained like never before for that Grandma's Marathon in 1981. 2 days before the race, I grabbed my bags out of my little apartment, grabbed the mail out of the post box, throw it in the back seat, throw the mail over on the empty passenger seat, and I start driving north out of Minneapolis to Duluth, Minnesota. All I can think about is the race coming up in 2 days. It was consuming me. So I thought, Dick, you got to get your mind off that race. And I looked over at my pack of mail, and I happened to see one of my running magazines had come, so I thought, I'll just read that while I'm driving to Duluth. Well, that's not the smartest thing to do. But I flipped open the magazine to not any particular page, and boom, these big, bold, black headlines on the top of the page it turned to. John Graham of England runs 2 hours, 9 minutes, 45 seconds at the Rotterdam Marathon. At the time, it was the fourth or fifth fastest marathon time ever run by a human being ever. So I read the article, and I thought, I better put that magazine down and keep driving to Duluth. Well, in the U.S., along the interstate highway systems, they have markers every mile. In case you ever break down, you can call the police and say, I'm at mile such and such. Well, the first mile marker that I see along the interstate is mile marker number 209. Now, I'm always looking for positive things in my life from the moment I wake up in the morning. And now I'm thinking to myself, gosh, I flip open this magazine. First thing I see is a big 209 sticking out at me. The first mile marker I see is mile marker number 209. And I'm thinking, am I going to run a 2 hour and 9 minute marathon on Saturday? Now, my best was that London Marathon, a little under 212. You think, well, 212 to 209, that's only 3 minutes. But 3 minutes at that end of the scale is like night and day difference. Well, I finally pull into the big Radisson Hotel there in downtown Duluth, and I walk in with my bags up to the front desk. I ask the lady there if she has a room for me. She says, you bet, Mr. Beardsley. And she walked in the back room, came back out with a packet of information and my room keys, and wished me good luck. So I grabbed the keys. I walked around to where the elevators were. The doors were open, and I walked on, and the doors shut behind me. Thankfully, I was the only one on that elevator at that time. And I'm thinking, well, I guess I better see what room I'm in. So I look at my key, and I start jumping up and down, hollering and screaming like a little kid that just got a brand new train set for his birthday. What room do you think I was in? 209. Not even close. But I was in room 902. And in my goofy little head, backwards, that's 209. Now, I didn't know if I was going to win that race on Saturday, but I knew without a doubt I was going to run a 209 marathon. And on that, 2 days later, I ran my very first grandma's marathon. And I was very fortunate to not only win that race, but when I crossed the finish line, the clock stopped in 2 hours, 9 minutes, and 36 seconds. Now, would I have run a 209 that day if I hadn't seen all those positive things? More than likely, yes. But anything you can do to keep that passion going, to keep that positivity going, that will calm you down, to enable you to move forward, then do it. And after that race, my next goal was this: the Boston Marathon. That video you just saw. So every step I took from then until the following April, every race I ran was to get ready for that Boston Marathon. And where I live in northern Minnesota, it gets very, very cold. And you do whatever it takes. You continue with that passion. Like that picture there. I just gotten back from about a 20-kilometer run. It was minus 40 degrees. That's all frost and snow and whatnot from breathing through that very, very cold air. When you have a passion for something, you don't let anything get in your way, including minus 40 degrees. But I knew this about Boston. I was a little bit paranoid. And I'm going to talk about that now, about paranoia. A lot of people think, oh, it's not good to be paranoid. Well, not all the time, but about some things. A little bit of paranoia in your life, it keeps you on your toes. It keeps you wanting to be in front and ahead of that competition, those people that are out there trying to get you. If you know your competition, you can know a little bit about what to expect. There are three people that I was very paranoid from at that point when I was getting ready for the Boston Marathon. The first gentleman was this guy right here, the guy on the right, a guy named Bill Rogers. Bill Rogers had won the Boston Marathon not just once or twice or three times. He had won the Boston Marathon 4 times. The next guy I was paranoid about that was going to be in that 1982 Boston Marathon was this gentleman right here, Frank Shorter, the American gold medalist in the Olympic marathon. And then the third gentleman I was paranoid about was this man here, Alberto Salazar. He'd never been beaten in the marathon. He was the world record holder at the time. I knew I had to train even harder and do things even differently to compete against those three particular people. But I was ready because I had the positivity. I had the passion. I had that little bit of paranoia that kept me on my feet. And then it came down to perseverance. The last of the four P's I want to talk about today. You see, no matter how successful you are, at times you will start moving forward, but then sometimes you step back a little bit. And it's in those moments when you have that little bit of a setback that you got to keep moving forward and keep persevering. That's what it's about. That's how you become successful. But I'll never forget that day in April 19th of 1982. The Boston Marathon started at 12 noon back then. I remember standing on that very front row when the starter puts up his pistol and he hollers, 1 minute. And I look to my left and there's that one gentleman I was a little paranoid about, Bill Rogers. I look a little further down that front line, and there's the other person, one of them, Frank Shorter, the gold medalist. And I look to my right, and standing 2 feet from me is the world record holder, Alberto Salazar. And with that, the gun went off, and Salazar shot out of there like he was shot from a rocket ship. I was right along his side. We went through the first kilometer in under 2 minutes and 50 seconds, and I'm hanging on for dear life. And let me tell you, when you're hanging on and still have 41 kilometers to go, that is not a good feeling to have. But I just kept telling myself, Dick, you'll be fine. You know, you're a little nervous. Biggest race of your life. As the next couple of kilometers went by, I didn't feel any better. When I hit the 5K point, I felt so bad. The first thought to cross my mind, and I'm one of the most positive people you will ever meet, was to drop out. How different my life would be today if I had taken that easy way out, made up some crazy excuse that everybody would have believed. I can 100% guarantee you if I had done that, I would not be here today. It's those moments that every one of us, whether it be an individual or a company, when we don't think we can take another step forward, yet we do. And we take another one after that, and another, and another. And I thought, Dick, you can't drop out. You've worked too hard for this. Hang in there. Finally, I started feeling a little bit better. And as each kilometer went on, that lead pack I was in, it got smaller and smaller and smaller until we got just before the 30-kilometer mark when there were two people left in that lead group. Salazar, the world record holder, and as the Boston Globe newspaper had dubbed me the day before in the paper, Dick Beardsley, the poor farm kid from Minnesota. Nobody had given me, or for that matter, anyone else, much of a chance against Salazar. Well, when you make that turn at about 30 kilometers, for about the next 6 or 7 kilometers, there's a series of 4 hills, each one getting steeper and longer than the one before. And my coach, Bill Squire, says, Dickie, when you hit those hills, I want you to run up them as hard as you can, and on the downside even faster. So like a good soldier listening to his commander, I hit that first hill and I did everything I could to shake Salazar. But he was right there. Same with the second, same with the third hill, but I could not shake him. Finally, I'm at the base of the infamous Heartbreak Hill. It's nearly 2 kilometers long and very steep. I ran up that hill as hard as I could. I get to the very top and I look over my shoulder and Salazar is right there. On the down portion of it, I literally was doing the 100-meter sprint trying to break away from him. When I got to the bottom, he was so close, I didn't have to turn around to see if he was still there. I could hear him breathing. At that point, I could no longer feel my legs. The thought of having to run 8 more kilometers at that pace or faster literally made me sick to my stomach. But I knew this. I knew no matter how bad I was hurting, I knew I could run another kilometer. And so my brain convinced my body that you don't have to run 8 more kilometers, just 1 more. Now all of a sudden that task at hand, it didn't seem so daunting. Sometimes if we break things down a little bit, it makes all the difference in the world. And the next kilometer went by and the next, and I still had that little bit of a lead and a little bit of a lead, even though I was doing everything I could to shake them. And then as long as I live, I'll never ever forget what I saw next. In front of me on that road in golden blue paint, it said 40 kilometers. And right below that, it said 2 kilometers to go. At that point, I got so weak-kneed and rubber-legged, I honestly did not know if I'd be able to take another step. At that point, for some reason, tears just started streaming down my cheeks. At that point, for some reason, I flashed back to that day in May of 1975 when I walked off my high school stage, the first one in my family to get a high school diploma. And I walked out to where my mom and dad were sitting. And my dad, who had an 8th grade education, was crying. I handed my dad my diploma. He handed me a small little envelope and he said, "Here, Dee, this is your graduation gift from your mom and I." I opened it up, and inside that little envelope was a small piece of paper in my dad's eighth grade handwriting. It said, "Dee, this is good for round-trip airfare to the Boston Marathon. Maybe someday you'll want to run it. Love, Mom and Dad." Here I was not only running it, but I was winning it. And they knew my folks were back home in Minnesota watching it on television. I remember thinking to myself, "Dick, you've got to get your mind off your mom and dad. Think about something else, anything." I finally thought back to a terrible blind date I once went on in high school. I knew that was going to come in handy. And it did, and I got my mind off my mom and dad, back into the race. And with a little over 900 meters to go, I had the biggest lead I'd had all day long, an arm length and a half. Now, I knew Salazar didn't have a great finishing sprint, but I knew he had a lot better one than I had. And at that point, I started pumping my legs and lifting my arms and doing everything I could to break away from Salazar. And as I pushed off with my right leg, I got the biggest Charlie horse cramp in my right hamstring. It literally set me up in the air. Salazar went flying by me like I was standing still. 5 meters, 10 meters, 30 meters. At one point, he had almost a 100-meter lead. But I learned more about myself. In those last 2 minutes of that race, that has enabled me to get through way more difficult situations in my life than that 1982 Boston Marathon. And what I learned on those roads in Boston almost 38 years ago is that no matter how difficult the situation you're in is, no matter how high you think that so-called mountain is to climb, is that you never, ever, ever give up. As long as you're moving forward towards that so-called finish line, there's always that hope. And it's about believing in yourself. It's about determination and commitment, staying positive, keeping that passion, having faith, being in the right place at the right time, and keep persevering. As Salazar kept getting further down the road, I'm running along the right-hand side the best I can, trying to work the cramp out. When the crowd moved back to let me come by, and as they did, I happened to be in the right place at the right time. My right foot came down into a big pothole I didn't see. I hit that pothole and I stumbled and almost fell to the ground. But when I almost fell to the ground, it jerked my right leg, and when it did, it popped the knot right out. Now I got my stride back. But now we're down to about 600 meters to go. I knew it was going to be difficult, but I thought, "Dick, if you don't give it your very, very best, you're going to regret it for the rest of your life." Well, you saw the outcome of that race. I finally caught back up to Salazar on the very last turn after I went around those motorcycles. I caught back up to him at that point, and now after running over 41 kilometers, it now came down to basically a 100-meter sprint. As I think Jim mentioned, we both were fortunate to break the American record and the Boston course record. It was the first time 2 men had ever gone under 2 hours and 9 minutes. In the same marathon. Alberto ran 2 hours, 8 minutes, and 51 seconds. I ran 2 hours, 8 minutes, and 52.6 seconds. 1.6 seconds. Buddies of mine called me later that afternoon on the phone. We didn't have all the social media like today. And they're going, "Beards, congratulations, but you mean to tell me in a race that's 42 kilometers long, you couldn't have made up 1.6 seconds somewhere along the way?" But at the end of the day, as long as you know you gave your very, very best, how can you be disappointed in that? That race took me to another level. It made my passion even more so. I got invited to races around the world, got to go to places I'd only read about or dreamed about. Not only were many experts picking me to make the 1984 U.S. Olympic marathon team, many of them were picking me to win a medal. Some even a gold medal. But remember what I said. Sometimes we have little things that get in our way, that keep us from perhaps pursuing that goal or that dream. 9 months before the Olympics in Los Angeles, I blew out my left Achilles tendon. Not once, but twice. The U.S. Olympic orthopedic surgeon rebuilt it. It took me almost 2 years before I could get back to start running again. So the 84 Olympics went out the window, but I thought I got to give it at least one more shot. And I tried to get ready for the 1988 Olympics in Seoul, South Korea. I got over my injury. I trained hard, but I just couldn't quite get back to that level again. I ran the Olympic trials and didn't run very well that year. And then I retired from competitive running. Still going to run every day, but just not at that high level. You know, as an athlete, you only have so many good years when you start having diminishing returns. Unlike in a business, where you can keep growing and growing and growing and growing. It doesn't matter how old you are. If you follow those four P's, you can continue that growth. So I moved back to my Minnesota dairy farm. Going to milk my cows, do my fishing guide service, raise a bunch of kids, and life was going to be grand. And it absolutely was until November 13th. 1989. I got up that Monday morning at 3:45 in the morning like I always did. I walked out of my house and I walked out to my dairy barn. I milked my 70 or so cows, got done doing a few other chores, and then I walked out of my barn back towards the house to give my family a good morning hug and an I love you. I got halfway between my barn and the house, and I stopped dead in my tracks, thinking about all the more important things that I thought I needed to get done at that point. I thought, gosh, Dick, you got 3 wagon loads of corn to unload. The neighbor's coming over to help you finish combining. And the weather service says a big snowstorm's due to hit. You know what, Dick? You can tell your family you love them tonight and give them a big hug at supper. So I turned around and walked the opposite direction. Big, big mistake. Anytime you have the opportunity to tell the people you love that you love them, you never, ever pass on that opportunity. Because it might not be there later. Mine almost wasn't. I walked down a small hill. I jumped up onto one of my farm tractors. I sat in the seat, started the key, throttled it all the way down. That engine was snorting like a freight train. I jumped off my tractor. I walked to the back. And I pulled the lever. And when I pulled the lever, that long shaft you see there in that picture started rotating at 600 revolutions a minute. It's called a power takeoff. And I turned like this. And when I turned, the next thing I realized, I thought somebody had come up from behind me, grabbed me by my shoulder blades, body slammed me backwards into the ground. And the next thing I realized, my left leg was being wrapped around that spinning shaft like taking a piece of string and wrapping it around your finger. When it couldn't take my leg anymore, it started taking my whole body around and around and around. Each time it would slam my head into the frozen ground, and I could feel myself losing consciousness, and I knew if that happened, it would be all over. But then on this very cold, gray November morning, all of a sudden it got so bright out. It was like looking up at the sun, taking it times 100. What felt like I was spinning around like a fast top, now it felt like super slow motion. And all that noise, it was as now as quiet as the inside of a library. Was I having a near-death experience? That's all I can tell you that must have been. And I came around that one last time, and somehow my arm grew long enough to where I could barely get my hand on that lever. And it stopped the rotation. To this day, I have no idea how I got myself out of that tangled mess. But the next thing I do remember is I'm standing next to my tractor, and I'm pretty much completely naked. It had torn all my clothes off. All I'm thinking, I'm in shock. I had no idea I was even hurt until I tried to take a step towards the house, and I face planted into the frozen ground. And I knew something wasn't right because my left foot was sitting in my left ear. I came to find out later I had all kinds of head contusions, broke all the ribs on my right side, punctured my right lung, broke my right arm, had a piece of steel driven into my chest, and my left leg was almost torn off. I knew I needed to get help, but I didn't know where my then wife Mary was, if she was in the house or the barn. I knew my little boy Andy was off to kindergarten at school, but I knew I had to get help. And in situations like that, you do anything. You persevere. Finally, I got found, and I ended up getting into the hospital, and I had wonderful doctors and surgeons and physical therapists and nurses and people I didn't even know. Twice they thought they're going to have to amputate my leg. But eventually I got back to the farm, got back to milking my cows, doing my fishing business, and I even got back to running a little bit again. Life was going pretty well again for the next couple years until I was coming home from a meeting when a lady ran a stop sign on a country road and smashed into my car, completely totaled it out, broke up my back, in the hospital, more surgeries. But I survived. I even actually got back to running again. And for the most part, life was going good again until that winter when I'm running in a town near where I live in a snowstorm down a street and I got hit from behind by a truck. They found me laying in a snowbank. Back in the hospital, more surgeries, but I survived. Everything was going good until that following spring when I was hiking in a very hilly area with my little boy Andy and a friend of his. Thankfully, the boys were about 30 meters behind because I got to the very top of this very steep embankment. I took one more step, and when I did, the ground broke away and I fell off a cliff. Back in the hospital, more surgeries, but I survived. And people would look at me, they'd say, "My goodness, Beardsley, if you didn't have bad luck, you wouldn't have any luck at all." But honestly, folks, I never ever looked at it like that. When things aren't going your way, you just have to, again, persevere and keep moving forward no matter what. Yes, there might be a setback, a time or two, but don't let that setback be who you are. Continue to move forward. But you can take all those accidents I just talked about, all the surgeries, 20 plus to put my body back together. You can take all of those, put them into a big, big mixer, mix them all up, drink it down, and it pales to what happened a short time later. I'm a loving husband to my wife, Jill. I'm a loving dad to my two stepsons, Matthew and Christopher, and to my son, Andy. And I'm a drug addict. My addiction was to narcotic painkillers. Over the years, so many people have tried to make excuses for me. "Oh, Dick, it's not your fault. It's those doctors. They gave you all those prescriptions." Not once have I ever put the blame on anybody else. That would have been the easy thing to do, but not the right thing to do. Every doctor I got a prescription from told me the dangers of being on it for too long. None of them ever forced me to take it. And I kept going to different doctors to get more and more medicine. And then when I couldn't find any more doctors, I started to actually forge my own prescriptions. I'd never done anything wrong in my life, never stole a piece of bubble gum. And now I'm doing something where I could lose everything I'd ever worked for in my life. I could have gone to prison, but all that mattered at that point in my life was to get the drugs, to take the drugs, and make sure I didn't get caught. What I'm telling you about this part of my life barely skims the surface. Thankfully, in September of 1996, I got caught. I knew I was in a lot of trouble, but I was so blessed And I was so thankful I was still alive. I knew the only chance I had, if there was any chance at all to get better, was to be 100% truthful and take responsibility for my actions. And that's what I did. Long story short, I was given 5 years of probation. And I got right into a hospital for treatment. I can't even begin to tell you what it was like going through the withdrawals from those opioids. I remember laying in my hospital bed, the pain in my bones and my arms and legs from the withdrawals was so intense that I can honestly say to you, if I would have had access to a saw, I honestly think I may have sawed off my own arms and legs. It would have had to felt better. In the morning when it was time to get up, it was a struggle to put my legs on the outside of the bed and to put on a clean pair of pants. It seemed like it took me forever. But I never, ever missed a meeting with my group to try to learn how to get better. And there were mornings I was so sick, I could not stand up and walk down the hallway to my group meeting. I had to crawl on my hands and knees like a dog. And one morning I'm crawling along the hallway trying to get to my group meeting, and I blacked out. I have no idea how long I laid there. But when I woke up, I was laying in my own vomit. And I remember looking up and saying, God, please, God, either just take me right now, or please, God, help get me better. And fortunately, God made me and helped me persevere. And that night, I actually slept a little bit because I hadn't slept in over a week. And the next day, a little bit more and a little bit more. And after I'd been there for about 30 days, I started to feel what it was like to be me, Dick Beardsley, without those drugs in my body, and I liked how it made me feel. Has it been easy? Absolutely not. But anything that you do that's worth pursuing, and that includes FHH, it's worth every effort that you put into it. In the last almost 23 years I've had of sobriety from those drugs, have been some of the best years I've ever had in my life. And when I look back, after that Boston Marathon in 1982, and I recovered after a month or so, I remember thinking, well, Dick, one thing you know for sure is that you will never have to go through anything more difficult than that 1982 Boston Marathon again. And I really firmly believed it. Well, I was wrong. And then after all those accidents I had in a short period of a few years, and all the surgeries to put me back together, once I recovered from that, I thought, well, I sure wouldn't want to go through that again. But the good thing is, I know for a fact I'll never have to go through anything more difficult than that in my life. And I was for certain of it. But once again, I was wrong. After I had 3 or 4 years of sobriety from those drugs, I remember thinking, well, I would never, ever want to put my family through or myself what I went through with those drugs. But the good thing is I am 100% certain, unequivocally, that I, for a fact, will never, ever go through anything more difficult in my life again, and I absolutely believed it. But unfortunately, was wrong. This is a picture of my little boy, Andy. My wife and I couldn't have any of our own kids biologically, so we adopted Andy from Honduras. He was just a little tyke when we got him home, but he was our love and our joy. Even on those bad days when things weren't going right, he made me worth getting up. He grew into a wonderful young man, and at the age of 21, he joined the United States Army. I was so proud of him. More than anybody I've ever been more proud of in my life. And for him, it was an honor to serve his country. But like many soldiers, sometimes they see things and have to do things that aren't very pleasant. And my son Andy suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder. And 4 years ago, my son Andy took his life. He was only 31 years old. I was devastated. My little boy, gone. There's not a waking moment in my day that I don't think for at least a little bit about my son Andy. But believe it or not, knowing that he's no longer, thank you, knowing that he's no longer having those terrible nightmares, fighting that darkness, it brings me joy. And it leaves me with peace. And it gives me hope. Because I know down the road, someday again, I will be able to hold my son Andy in my arms and give him a hug. And once again, tell him how much I love him. And the one thing I know my son Andy would not have wanted was to me to have wallowed in my sorrow in his death. I know he would want me to move forward and continue my life in a positive way. I knew and know my Andy would want me to persevere and continue to move forward. So I've talked to you today about the four P's: the positivity, the passion, the paranoia, the perseverance, and how they led me to be successful as a runner and in my life, and how I know they can lead FHH to that continued 5 years of growth that you're all looking forward to trying to achieve by following those four P's. They've worked for me, and I know they can also work for you. And what will happen is that fourth P, by following those, it'll bring you to the finish line, and it gives you that fifth P. The proper preparation prevents poor performance. And you too can cross that finish line like a champion. Thank you, everybody. You've been absolutely wonderful. It's been great to be here. Jim, thank you very much. Take care and God bless you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.